So let us look at an example like this, where yeah, so we have a basic spring mass kind of system. So block of given mass, so 5 kilograms, is attached to a spring of given constant. Other side of the spring is attached to the wall. So this is a smooth surface. Now, given that the spring has a spring constant of, let us say, 25 newtons per centimeters. Now, initially, at t equal to 0, the block is pulled to the right, such that the spring is extended by initial value of x, so we'll take that as x naught equal to 2 centimeters, and released from rest. So basically, you are pulling the block from the original position where the spring would have been in natural length. So suppose the spring in this diagram was at natural length L. So now at t equal to 0 in this diagram, you have stretched the spring like this and then release the block from rest. So initial velocity of the block is 0. So immediately it will accelerate towards the left. So we want to find out the acceleration of the block immediately after it is released. Then we want to find out the maximum speed achieved by the block. Say that is V maximum. Then we also want to find out the maximum compression the spring will suffer, because as the block oscillates, keep going between a state of compression and expansion, mean position in between. Okay. And fourth, we want to find the speed V and acceleration E at an instant when the extension x is equal to 1 centimeter for the spring. So we release it from the 2 centimeter extension and the spring force starts pulling the block towards the left, you know, because the spring has got extended. So as the block moves towards the left, the extension of the spring is reducing. So by the time it has become 1 centimeters from its initial value of 2 centimeters, what is the speed picked up by the block and what is the acceleration? So let's work this out. And from this, we will finally also plot x versus t graph, where x, when it is positive, it represents extension of the spring, and x when it is negative represents compression of the spring. And secondly, again, V versus T graph, where V is the velocity of the block. Okay. Again, positive means towards positive velocity means towards the right, and negative velocity means towards the left. That is the sign convention we'll be using for this also. Okay, so I'll just minimize this a little and start by trying out the question. So actually everything that you need to solve this question we have discussed in the last few sessions, including, I'll give you a hint, the work energy session where we discussed about conservation of energy, and also the Newton's law session where net force is equal to mass into acceleration. So those kind of concepts you have to be applying over here. So just try this out, people. Yeah, Adinath, so you have to divide the force by mass na, to get acceleration. You have calculated force correctly. Ab usko mass se divide kar do. Yes, that's correct. Na. Yes, Bhagyashri, that's correct. Correct answer. Okay, so let's understand this question. So in the beginning, when you started the motion, the spring was in a highly stretched out kind of condition like this. The initial velocity is zero, and this is L plus X naught, the length of the spring. So if you look at the force acting on the spring, I mean on the block, it is KX naught. So it has an initial acceleration A naught in this direction towards the left. Initial acceleration. So this is the situation at t equal to 0. So at t equal to 0, the acceleration of the block is the spring force divided by the mass. So that is 25 into 2 divided by 5. This is in kgs. This will become in newtons because it was newton per centimeters into centimeters. So the initial acceleration is 10 meters per second square. And obviously it's towards the left side, and the direction of the acceleration is like this. Okay. Now compared to this, we'll also realize if we keep comparing at various different stages in the motion, we realize that, for example, by the time the block has, let's say, come somewhere here, where the spring is still stretched, it's not come back to its natural shape yet, but it's stretched by less. So in the second diagram, this length is L plus X, but X has now become less than the initial curve. So by the time it is here, it has got some speed also, apart from having some acceleration. So at some different time, let's say t1, so at t equal to t1, if x is this value, which is less than the initial value, then the acceleration is also kx by m. So the acceleration will also be less than e naught. Okay. Whereas now, what about the speed? How we'll find the speed? So we'll compare the two diagrams for work energy. Okay. So the sum of kinetic energy plus potential energy stored in the spring, which is the total mechanical energy, it is conserved. Going from this situation to this situation, so 1 to 2, if we go that way, you can see that in 1 we had only this. The potential, the kinetic energy was 0. In 2 we have kinetic energy plus some potential energy. So that is how we are getting V as a function of X. So solve this equation, we get V square is equal to K by M into X naught square minus X square. Or in other words, the speed of the block is square root of this term. So this is one of the expressions that we are going to use because we wanted to find the speed at a particular value of x later. So this is the general equation for acceleration. This is the general equation for the speed. Now naturally from this equation you can see that at what point of time the speed will become maximum. So you can see from this, therefore speed will be maximum when the term x naught square minus x square is maximum. So for that x should become 0. So the maximum speed it will achieve will be square root of k by m x naught square, or you can just write that as x naught into square root of k by m, which we'll calculate, but this will be at x equal to 0, that is the mean position. So this will occur at the mean position, which we can also show with the next diagram. So in the sequence of events, if we show the next diagram, as this, let's say, where now in this next diagram the spring has, let's say, come to the natural length position, so it is not stretched, extension is zero in it, so the spring is back to its original shape. So if that is the case, then in this diagram the speed will become maximum. So if this length is indeed equal to L, so this is the case where x is equal to 0. So this is the mean position. Okay. Then definitely the time at this point of time will be 1/4 of the time period. Where t is the time period. Okay. So therefore, from maximum extension, that is x equal to plus x naught, that is amplitude, to x equal to 0, that is mean position, it's 1/4 of the cycle, or the time taken is t by 4. So like that, that's why the time here is t by 4. So at t by 4, the speed will be maximum. So that is 2 into 10 raised power minus 2 into square root of 25 minus 2. Into 10 raised power 2, because k was 25 newtons per centimeter, so it will become 25 into 10 raised power 2 newtons per meter, okay, divided by the mass of the block, which was 5 kilograms. So as you can see, this will become 2.5. But the direction of the velocity will be backwards. So if you write with sign convention, you see that at this point of time, the velocity is minus of b max, because it's in the negative direction. Or you can just write that as (1/√5). Okay, so this is this much part of the motion so far. Now we'll also see next what happens after this, after it crosses the mean point. We'll understand what happens. Note this much down first. Yeah, so Adinath, what we are doing in this is that we are just using the work energy theorem. and for that we are taking a system as the block plus the spring. Right now, so the mechanical energy, so work done by external agent should be change in kinetic energy plus change in potential energy, but this thing is zero because there's no external agent doing work. Okay, so that means the sum of change in kinetic energy plus change in potential energy should be zero. So that means kinetic energy plus potential energy, which is the mechanical energy, should be constant. It should be conserved. Okay, so that's what we are applying. So now in the diagram one, you can see the potential energy is half kx naught square, kinetic energy is zero. So their sum is half kx naught square. So that's the left hand side of this equation at this moment. Okay. And in the second diagram that I've taken, the potential energy has become half kx square, but by now the kinetic energy has become half mv square. That's why the right hand side of this is the sum of these two. So hope it is clear now, Adinal. Good. So just one technicality here, the work energy equation will give us speed. It will not give us velocity with direction. The direction of velocity we have to figure out logically, you know, because this is telling us that magnitude of V is going to be so much, but whether it is in the positive X direction or negative X direction, that we have to see according to which point of time we are talking about in the cycle of oscillation. And from that we have to figure out whether the direction is towards the left or towards the right. So technically the work energy theorem gives us the speed and the magnitude of velocity. Okay, people, so hope it is clear up to this point. So once again, I'll take you back to the question because a lot of things have been asked in the question. So let's understand that. So we have reached up to this point. You've seen that the initial acceleration was kx naught by m. So that had worked out to be 10 meters per second square towards the left. Okay. The maximum speed we had seen was given by this formula, which came from work energy, and this came out to be 1 by root 5 meters per second. So this came from the fact that the speed is maximum when all the initial potential energy is converted to kinetic energy. So basically, maximum potential energy of half kx naught square at the amplitude position or extreme position is converted to maximum kinetic energy of half mv's maximum value square at the mean position. That's another easy way in which you can understand. How do I know what is the maximum speed? I know the maximum speed occurs at the mean position. So when you're moving from the extreme to the mean position, all your potential energy is converted to kinetic energy. So the maximum potential energy your system had, which was half kx naught square, is converted to the maximum kinetic energy now it has at mean position, which is half mv max square. That also shows you an easy way to understand the formula that v max is x naught into square root of k by n. Now we will think about what happens thereafter. We've reached the mean position and we've seen by the time it's come to the mean position, this is the speed. So from here, what happens in the next part of the motion, in the next part of the cycle? So we will see that the spring starts getting compressed. And as it gets compressed, again you are having loss of kinetic energy and gain of potential energy, and that process will continue, that is the compression will continue till the block converts all the kinetic energy again into potential energy. Now, so at that time it has just about reached the negative extreme, or it has reached the amplitude on the negative side. Okay, so we have to find that, and then we will come to the fourth and fifth part. So in case you haven't written down the solutions of the first two parts, let's go through this. The next part of the cycle, the motion, you understand what is happening here. Now we had come to that stage where the spring is back to natural length. And the block has maximum kinetic energy. So we are at the mean position. So notice one more thing, when you are at the mean position, the speed is maximum, but the acceleration is zero. The acceleration of the block is zero at this stage. Okay. So, because you know the spring is not applying any force, it is zero. So, acceleration is zero. Okay. But because of the momentum of the block, now it goes past that, no? So it goes to a position where x now becomes negative. And as x becomes negative, the spring is compressed. So once again, part of your kinetic energy is converted to potential energy. So now your spring being in a state of compression, it will apply a tension force of kx in the outward direction. It will push in this direction. So the force will be kx like this. So the block will have an acceleration like this, even though its speed is continued in this direction. So it has a decelerated motion, x equal to some negative value, compression. What is happening is that the block is decelerating. Because acceleration is opposite to the velocity's direction. So kinetic energy is decreasing as potential energy is increasing. So once again, this was the mean position diagram, the third one. If we compare 3 to 4, what is happening? This was the energy. Now this becomes this. So again, V is like this. Okay. So you can see from this, you understand what is happening. So V is decreasing as x increases. So x square increases as it. So again, what will happen is at maximum compression point, okay, V will become zero. So that means V max square minus K by M, this should be zero. So x maximum will become plus minus of this. So you will see that x maximum is plus minus of x naught only, because we had the equation that V max was equal to x naught square root k by m. So when you substitute that here, so this shows that maximum extension is this thing, and maximum compression So this is telling us that the maximum compression will be of 2 centimeters only. Okay, so therefore, the maximum compression for the spring is 2 centimeters only. That is x naught equal to 2 centimeters. So that will be, let's say, the fifth diagram that we can draw when it reaches the state where the block momentarily comes to rest. This is when you say that L minus X naught is the maximum compression state. And at this point of time, here the time was T by 4 mean position. Now it has reached the negative extreme. Okay, x is equal to minus x naught. So speed has become 0 and the time will be T by 2. Half the cycle is completed for the oscillation. Yes, so Adina, that is correct. So again, you can understand 3 to 5. Okay, what is happening is you're going from mean position, that is x equal to 0, to negative extreme, that is x equal to minus x1. So the time is T by 4 to T by 2. The amount of time delta t is again quarter cycle. It's a quarter cycle of the oscillation. Yes, so 1 to 3 is also a quarter cycle, that's correct, Adina. Okay, so now the rest of the part of the oscillation, you can see it is just coming back, you know? So from this it will come back to the position. Of mean position in another quarter cycle. So from here to here is coming back to the mean position, and when it's here, again have maximum speed, but this time in the opposite direction, and its acceleration will again become zero, and the time here will become three quarters of the cycle, because here to here is another quarter cycle. Okay, and then from here back to the original position where you are at plus x naught or the positive extreme. So when you reach here, again, your speed becomes zero and cycle is completed. So this is the completion of the first cycle, and then this whole process repeats. Okay, so from t equal to 0, where you were at plus x naught, the position was at the positive extreme, to the mean position, quarter of a cycle, then mean position to negative extreme, this one, another quarter cycle, so half the cycle is over, then negative extreme to back to mean position, another quarter cycle, and then mean position back to the positive extreme, the last quarter cycle, so one complete cycle is done. Yes, very good, Adinath. So now let's verify your answer. So for this next part, the fourth and fifth part, let's understand. So in the fourth part, we want to calculate, we want to find out V when X is equal to 1 centimeter. That is x naught by 2, because x naught was equal to 2 centimeters. So we have that relation that half mv square plus half kx square is equal to half kx naught square. So in this expression, we have to substitute this thing. So half mv square plus, now we can directly substitute x as x naught by 2. Because 1 centimeter is x naught by 2. Okay, so we'll see that this is V, not V naught. To be like this. Okay, now we had seen that V max was x naught under root k by m, and that was 1 by root 5 meters per second. So this will be square root of 3 by 4 times, or root 3 by 2 times. Or you can also write this as square root of 15 by 10, whichever works out more conveniently. So this will be the speed in meters per second at the instant when the compression of the spring is 1 centimeters, as opposed to the maximum compression, which was 2 centimeters. Okay, now as far as the acceleration is concerned, that's very simple. The acceleration was simply given by the formula. At any point of time, if the spring is extended by x, okay, then the spring force is kx. So it creates an acceleration of kx divided by the mass of the block. So it's very simple. So therefore, from this you can understand that when at x equal to 1 centimeters, the acceleration will be 25 into 1 by 5 meters per second squared. But again, for x equal to plus 1 centimeters extension, E will be 5 meters per second square towards left. It will be towards the mean position. Fixing that one. Let him do two. Okay, so finally, when we look at the graphical representation, this entire motion, so starting with the position versus time graph or xt graph, where x is basically the extension of the spring, you can see that the oscillation cycle had started from the positive extreme. So x will start from the initial value of plus x naught, which was 2 centimeters. Will start from this value of plus x naught, and of course varies between plus and minus x naught. So this is what the oscillation cycle will look like. This is one cycle completed. And then of course it continues from here. So it continues oscillating n number of cycles. But this is quarter of the cycle. This is 3/4 of the cycle. So this is your x versus t graph, whereas your corresponding velocity versus time graph, when you look at that one, so again it will vary between minus of Vmax and positive of Vmax, where that Vmax is magnitude was 1 by root 5 meters per second. X naught was 2 centimeters. So here correspondingly it's starting from rest, but it's moving towards the left. So the velocity increases on the negative side. And this is the completion of one cycle. So at T by 4, when it was at the mean position, it had a maximum negative velocity. Then at T by 2, it reached the negative extreme. So again, the block came to rest. And at 3/4 of the cycle, it was going through the mean position once more on the way to the positive extreme. So it has positive velocity and maximum. And at quarter cycle, it's again reached the extreme. And from here, the whole thing continues cyclically the same way. Okay, so people hope this question is fully clear now. Okay, so now from this type of situation where we are looking at oscillations in detail, we move more towards waves now. So let's understand a few general things about waves first before we can start writing equations and understanding mathematical properties. So the general definition, what is a wave phenomena? Wave motion or any type of wave phenomenon, so called. This is defined by a situation where energy propagates along a medium through the vibration or you can say oscillations. Of its particles, but such that the mean position of these particles does not change. So whatever type of example you take of a wave, whether you take the example of a wave as the waves propagating along a string or rope, or you take the example of waves on the surface of water, basically ripples on a lake surface, the surface of a lake or a tank or whatever. Something like that, or something more extreme, or ocean waves. Or you even visualize something a little more abstract, like sound waves. Okay, so these are propagating through air. In all of these examples, or even something much more abstract, like a Mexican wave in a crowd, in a stadium. So people alternately stand up and sit down. So they are not moving from their mean position, but the disturbance of the wave and the energy of the wave is traveling from point to point within the medium. So in all these examples, this is what is happening. The mean positions of the particles are fixed. Okay. But the energy, and by energy we mean here mechanical energy, that is kinetic and potential, propagates or travels in the medium. So this is the general sort of, you know, sort of the broad or wide kind of description of wave phenomena. Now within this there are many smaller categories and sub classifications and all that. Okay. But the widest sort of definition of a wave phenomena is something like this. It involves transferring energy from point to point in a medium or from particle to particle in a medium via their vibrations or oscillations. But they oscillate or vibrate in such a way that their mean position is never shifting. So when for example, you have like this, you have created a pulse in a string and that pulse is traveling like this. You can see that the energy of the pulse is traveling from point to point. Okay. But none of the particles of the string are actually traveling along the direction of velocity. They are just disturbed going up and coming back, and then they remain fixed at their mean position. So it's like, you know, if you have put a marker, color marker on any point in the string, you won't see that that color marker point has actually moved from here to here, from one end of the string to the other end of the string. Okay. But the energy of the pulse has moved from one end of the string to the other end of the string. So how the energy has moved? It has moved by each particle transferring its mechanical energy to the next particle as the wave shifts. As the pulse shifts from point to point, each particle shifts its energy from itself to the next point. And that's how the energy propagates. So this is an example of a pulse traveling along a rope or a string. So the particles of the string don't move along with the energy of the pulse. Their mean position remains fixed, but through their oscillation energy or through their mechanical energy getting transferred from point to point on the string, energy, mechanical energy is getting propagated. So this kind of a phenomena is called a wave phenomena. Yes, definitely waves are affected by gravity. Because the mechanical medium in which the waves are propagating, that will definitely be affected by gravity. So it has an effect. Okay, but a simple example of this, Yuvraj, would be that, see, if there was no gravity or if there weren't sufficient gravity on the earth, then the composition of our atmosphere would be very different. It would either be composed of much lighter gases or it would not even be composed of any gases at all. Like the surface of something like the moon or something, it hardly has any atmospheric air. It does not have any atmospheric air. So in that case, we cannot propagate sound, because sound has to propagate through the material particles of air. Or if the air is less dense, then the speed at which the sound waves are propagating will become more. Definitely the gravity has an effect on the medium, and therefore has an effect on the propagation of waves. And the propagation of waves, yes, it will be affected by friction in a system also. Okay, but remember that at our level here, we are studying systems where friction is negligible. Friction or any kind of resistive force is negligible. So, for instance, in the example that I've taken over here of the pulse traveling along the string, in my diagram, I'm showing that the shape of the pulse remains of same amplitude. It doesn't start decreasing because I have assumed that there is no drag force, there is no air friction, there is no resistance force, so there is no loss of energy. But in a real life situation, there will be some amount of attenuation or loss of energy. So as the pulse travels, its peak will start dipping in height. So that is the effect of, you know, drag forces or friction or resistive forces. So hope that makes the point clear, Yuvraj. Okay, now, as I was telling that this is the broad description of waves, and now depending on their different types of properties, we will divide mechanical waves into two categories. Now, mechanical waves, kya hote hain? They are waves where there are mechanical energy transferred from particle to particle via oscillation. Whereas there's another type of wave phenomena called electromagnetic waves. Light is an electromagnetic wave, for example. X-rays are electromagnetic waves. Microwaves are electromagnetic waves. Gamma radiations, these are radio waves. These are all examples of electromagnetic waves. And in electromagnetic waves, it is not mechanical energy, but rather it is electromagnetic energy that is transferred from point to point via vibration of electric field and magnetic field. So that is something a little bit more advanced and a little bit more complicated. So we will discuss about that in 11, 12 later. But here we are primarily, when we talk about waves, we are talking about mechanical waves. So it involves a material medium or a mechanical medium, and it involves oscillations of the particles of that medium. So coming back to the special category of waves, the more common types of waves that we experience in our lives are mechanical waves. All the examples I've taken above were examples of mechanical waves. So this is propagation of mechanical energy. Oscillations of propagation of mechanical energy through a material medium. Mechanical waves cannot propagate through space or vacuum, so there has to be some kind of material medium through the oscillations of the medium particles. Okay, this is in general a mechanical wave. Now, mechanical waves are divided into two categories, as you may well be aware: transverse waves and longitudinal waves. Now, transverse waves are basically what? They are waves where the medium particles are displaced, or you can say oscillate, along a direction perpendicular to the axis of propagation of the wave. So the immediate example which will make it clear what these type of waves are is the waves propagating through a string. So, you know, when you have this kind of a wave shape which is propagating through a string, so the shape of the string is continuously changing like this. As the wave is propagating, if you look at a medium particle, it is not moving along this direction, it is moving like this. This medium particle here is going like this, then back like this. So here, if this is your x-axis and this is your y-axis, the particles on the string vibrate along the y-axis, whereas the energy of the wave propagates along the x-axis. So these two are mutually perpendicular directions. So it comes in the category of transverse waves. Whereas longitudinal waves, these are the phenomena where medium particles oscillate along an axis which is the axis of energy propagation. So once again, it's very easy to understand this with a physical example. So imagine sound waves propagating through an air pipe or a wind pipe. So this is air inside, this is a wind pipe. So I have some kind of a source which is creating sound waves through this. So the air particles, they are vibrating like this. And the energy is also propagating along the same direction. So this is our x-axis. You can see that as sound waves propagate inside the windpipe, the air molecules oscillate along the x-axis. While the energy propagation is also happening along the x-axis. So that's why this is an example of a longitudinal wave. So just make a note of this, people. So let us look in more detail at transverse waves. Propagating on a string. And let's try to understand some mathematical relations in context of the wave. Okay. So if the string is like this, stretched out, the other end of the string is very far away. Okay. Whereas this end of the string, x equal to 0, like this. Okay. So this is a thread or a string. Okay. Now suppose if an external agent starts moving the end x equal to 0 of the string, in an oscillation motion along the y-axis. So if this is your y-axis, now initially imagine our external agent was holding this end of the string at rest. So the string looked like it's at, you know, rest in the horizontal position. But now what our external agent does is he or she starts forcing this point, which is the end of the string, to go up and down like this. So this point is forced to go up and down in an oscillation motion along the y-axis with a certain amplitude. And at a certain frequency f. So what will happen is the point x equal to 0 is made to oscillate along the y-axis, okay, with amplitude equal to capital A and frequency equal to f. So let us understand these two terms in detail first. Okay. So what is the amplitude? Amplitude is the maximum displacement, in this case along y-axis, okay, from the mean position. So that is the x-axis position. So that is y equal to 0. So in other words, the particle at x equal to 0 will oscillate between y equal to plus a and y equal to minus a, whereas y equal to 0 will be the mean position. And the other thing is the frequency. So what does the frequency mean? Frequency f, it is the number of cycles of oscillation per unit time. So in other words, frequency is 1 upon time period, where capital T is the time period of oscillation. So for example, if the time period of oscillation is 20 milliseconds, then the frequency will become 1 upon 20 into 10 raised power minus 3. So the frequency will become 1000 by 20, or that is 100 by 2 of 50 cycles per second. So cycles per second is also expressed as hertz. So the frequency will be expressed as 50 hertz. Okay. So we'll discuss more about hertz in the next video. Just make a note of this part first.
Okay, so hope you are clear with the concept of frequency and time period. Okay, so now you can see that if we analyze the oscillation of the particle at x equal to 0 along the y-axis. So its y-coordinate will vary with time, let's say along like this. It will continuously vary between the amplitude on the positive side of plus a, the mean position 0, and the amplitude on the negative side of minus a, just like that spring mass system we had seen just a little while back, where this will be one complete cycle, this will be half cycle, this will be quarter cycle, it will be three quarters of a cycle, like this. Okay, so here y is written as a function of time, like this. Why it is written like this is because, see, if you have an equation y is equal to sine theta, you know that it varies like this. If you were to plot y versus theta, that would vary like this between plus 1 and minus 1, such that it would reach plus 1 at pi by 2, again 0 at pi, minus 1 at 3 pi by 2. Okay. So pi is equivalent to 180 degrees, pi by 2 is 90 degrees, 3 pi by 2 is 270 degrees, and 2 pi is 360 degrees. So sine 0 is 0. Sine of 90 degrees is basically sine of pi by 2. So that is plus 1. Okay. Sine of 180 degrees is sine pi in radians, which is again 0. Sine of 270 degrees is sine of 3 pi by 2 in radians, which is minus 1, and then sine of 360 degrees is again sine of 2 pi in radians, which is 0. So according to these, you can understand this graph, and according to this graph now, you can understand the first graph. So in the first graph, you can see that what is happening at t equal to 1/4 of the cycle, y becomes a sine 2 pi upon time period into t by 4. So it becomes a sine pi by 2, which you can see is plus a. Because from here you can see that sine pi by 2 is plus 1. Similarly, at t equal to half cycle, t by 2, y becomes a sine 2 pi upon time period into t by 2. Okay. So it becomes a sine pi. Now sine pi from here you can see is 0. So the particle is back to the mean position. So this is what is happening at quarter cycle. This is even before this, at t equal to 0, y is equal to a sine 0. It is 0. So 0 to positive extreme in first quarter cycle, then positive extreme back to mean position in the next quarter cycle. Okay. And like that, this progression continues. So just make a note up to here, we'll discuss further. Okay, so Dhruv, just copy down this graph of y equal to sine theta. Okay, I'm copying down these values, this and this part. Then again, I'll explain how that converts into the oscillation graph. Yeah, so Dhruv, is the sine theta graph clear to you? The one on the side? Okay, so now see how it converts to this graph. So yahan pe, when instead of y equal to sine theta, we have a graph of y is equal to capital A into sine of this term. 2 pi by capital T into small t. So what is happening, that theta, the equivalent of theta, if you compare these two, is 2 pi upon whatever time period into small t. So you can see that when t is equal to 0, theta is equal to 0. And at that point of time, you can see sine theta is 0 because you know this. Okay. But for example, at quarter cycle, t equal to t by 4, see what theta is becoming. Multiply this with t by 4, so it's becoming pi by 2. So now you know what is sine pi by 2. It is 1. So if sine pi by 2 is 1, what about the value of y? The value of y will become plus a. Y will become plus a. Here y was 0 in this equation. Now you can see. Okay. So similarly, at t equal to capital T by 2, the value of theta is becoming how much? It's becoming pi. So sine of theta, which is sine pi, is becoming how much? It's 0 again. So that means y is 0. So in the graph, you can see in the oscillation, at half the cycle, the particle's position is back to y equal to 0. Okay, is it clear now how this cycle is progressing? So further, at 3/4 of the time period, this will become 3 pi by 2. Or that's 270 degrees, the value over here. So now sine theta's value is becoming minus 1. So accordingly, y's value is becoming minus a. So as your time is progressing from 0 to quarter cycles, to half cycle, to 3/4 of the cycle, to the full cyclical time, the quantity that you are operating sine on, the theta's value, is changing from 0 to pi by 2 to pi to 3 pi by 2 to 2 pi finally for the full cycle. So accordingly your oscillation cycle is getting computed. So this is how we describe the oscillation of that particle. Okay. Now how we will represent this for any other particle in the string. Okay. So this equation that we written, this was for y at x equal to 0. This was given by this formula. In fact, we write this as a constant omega into t. Okay, where omega is nothing but 2 pi upon time period. So the term omega is specifically called angular frequency of the oscillation. Okay, because it can be written as 2 pi multiplied by frequency. And obviously capital T is time period and F is frequency. Okay. So omega, the angular frequency, is expressed in radians per second, whereas time period is expressed in seconds. Frequency is expressed in hertz. So 1 hertz is 1 cycle per second. So anyway, these are the units. So this is the oscillation for the particle which is located at x equal to 0. Now along the string, what is happening? If I have another particle P, this was the origin point, at x equal to x, these oscillations which are happening, they are traveling along the string at a fixed speed v. So v is the propagation speed of the wave. So the wave phenomena is propagating along the string, along the x-axis at this speed. Therefore, if O, that is the particle at x equal to 0, starts oscillating at time t equal to 0, okay, and it's given by the equation A sine omega t. Okay. Then the point P, which is at x equal to x, will start oscillations at some delayed time t equal to delta t, because the distance between these two points is x. So whatever starts here at t equal to 0, it reaches here at a certain delta t delay time, which is nothing but x by v. So that the distance through which the oscillations are traveling, or the disturbance of the wave is traveling, is x, and is traveling at a speed v. Okay. So therefore the equation for this point P's oscillation, so P oscillates by the equation A sine omega into t minus delta t, because its oscillation has not started at t equal to 0. It has started after a delay of delta t. So for it, any amount of time is less than 0 to t. It is from delta t to t. So the time factor is t minus delta t. Okay. Now substitute this value of this over here. So you can see that it is given by this equation. Omega into t minus x by v, or we can write the equation for oscillation at any general point P as A sine omega t minus some constant k into x, where omega already we have seen is 2 pi into frequency, or 2 pi upon time period, and k is nothing but omega by v. If we just compare these two equations, this equation with this, you can see the value of k is this. Okay, so later we will understand that k is nothing but 2 pi upon lambda, where lambda is the wavelength. Okay, so this finally here becomes the general equation of the wave. So like this. Okay, people, so this is the point where we'll stop today, the general equation of wave derivation. And next time we will discuss more about the application of this, and we'll discuss about more properties of the wave, like wavelength lambda and the relationship between frequency, wavelength and wave speed, things like that. Okay. So that's it for today. All the best until next time. So revise this session's contents, particularly the example we did of the oscillating system, the spring mass system, and you can look up the some of the questions and the theory part of waves chapter from your physics module 1. Is the last chapter of that module, wave motion or waves. So you can start looking into that and start working out some of the questions from the exercises also. Okay, and we will complete that in the next lecture. Okay, so that's it for today, people. All the best.